Hello! In this video, we will take you on a journey through a small game world and showcase the non-Euclidean transformations of its third dimension. A game has to take place on something. Let us start with a simple, boring, two-dimensional board tied with squares, as in chess or simple video games. You now see how our world would look like in chess diagrams or every video games. In those games, we can move only in two dimensions. Even if the game takes place on a flat surface, you probably imagine it as if you were floating above the ground like this. More modern video games allow the player to move the point of view in all three dimensions and change their perspective. But maybe there are other options to add the third dimension, or depth, to our game? You might have noticed that our map repeats itself. A similar thing happened in early video games such as Pac-Man or Asteroids. And yes, I hear you. I know. You may doubt it. Like Pac-Man or Asteroids, simple rules, one and only screen. If you cross the left edge of the world, you reappear on the right edge. No repetitions. No. Nope. No repetitions. Okay. Sure, but this is only because these games used a fixed camera position. What would happen if the camera was always centered on the player character? Next to the player character, we would always see what is close to them, and thus the view would repeat. So what we see here is the same, but in three dimensions. But maybe it's not the world that repeats, but the world is simply wrapped in a cylinder. Now the game is played on the inside of the cylinder. We could also imagine it to be played on the outside. Now you might have noticed that our world repeats not only horizontally, but also vertically. Can we bend and wrap both dimensions at once? Some of you probably thought of taking both ends of a cylinder and connecting them in a donut-like shape. More professionally, a torus. Well, that's a nice idea, keep that in mind, but for now we want something different, something that you might have seen in video games. What is that? Is it a sphere? No, it is not. See, it's tiled with squares. By Euler's polyhedron formula, we can prove that it is not actually possible to tile a sphere with squares. Here we have the same object, but the square grid is harder to see until we move to the flat modes in this game. So we see a sphere, but it cannot be a sphere, so what's that and why something like this? These video games must be cheating somehow. So here you are, here is the same cheat, but in our small world. How to explain that? Better drink some coffee and grab some cheese while we are thinking about this. Hello, Mr. Rat. What a nice cheese with holes. Such great holes. Holes. How about a hole in our world so we can see what lies below? No. We cannot destroy our beautiful world. The tulips would be lost. And the cat and the bunny would be in danger. Also, actually, typical games also do not allow you to do so. So, no holes. No. What's that noise? An evil investor has dug out a big hole in our world. It's actually just what we needed. We will use it to move to the other side of our strange object. I suppose you expect it to look like the inside of a sphere. So, now we see our fake sphere from the inside. How do you feel about it? Aren't you surprised? It was not really tiled with a finite number of squares. On the inside, our world also repeats infinitely. Well, probably it's time to name this strange object. It's called a horosphere. We cannot have a horosphere in the Euclidean geometry. To build it, we actually had to change how the space itself works. For an explanation, look at this structure. You can treat it as a kind of a skeleton of our space. All the red segments are vertical and of the same length, and all the purple segments are horizontal and also of the same length. Note that on every level a horizontal segment corresponds to two segments on the level below. The same doubling would continue infinitely below the ground. In this world, just like in ours, light always takes the shortest path. Since horizontal distances are shorter upwards, the light will not go horizontally, but curve upwards. That is why those horizontal lines look curved. I said we had needed to change the geometry. While cylinders could be built in Euclidean geometry, we cannot build horospheres there, simply because there would be not enough space. However, our construction fits perfectly in hyperbolic geometry. Do you remember right-angled pentagons from our previous videos? It is the same geometry. So, in some sense, the games we have shown were using non-Euclidean geometry. Why aren't they advertised so? On one hand, this has no practical relevance to the actual gameplay, contrary to an actual non-Euclidean game such as Hyper Rogue. Well, at least if it is done on the outside of the Horosphere. When done on the inside, it could be an interesting setting for a first-person shooter, for example. Or at least I think so. On the other hand, the same visual effect could be obtained using the stereographic projection, which I suppose is how most game devs think about it. These were the things that do appear in games, at least in some sense. But if you want something more exotic, there are more possibilities. In our horospherical construction, each vertical level doubled distances in both x and y coordinates. Let's change that. Here, each vertical level doubles distances in x, but in y, the distances are tripled. As a result, when we move the camera away, the squares no longer look like squares. Also, the horizontal levels look more like ellipsoids. Such effects are typical to anisotropic geometries. To see those effects more clearly, we will come back to the surface. Follow me. Here is another strange word. This time, each vertical level doubles the distances in x, but halves the distances in y. Now, the light rays in the x direction curve upwards, while the rays in the y direction curve downwards. As a result, the effect looks a bit like a torus. This is the Solv geometry, which you might have already seen in our portals video. Let's fly in a straight line for a while. As you can see, the straight lines or geodesics in Solv are quite complicated. Do you see why the shortest paths in Solv behave this way? We will explain it in a moment, but if you want to think about it by yourself, please feel free to pause the video. Imagine you want to go from the point A to the point B. Of course, we could reach this point without leaving the plane. This plane is Euclidean, so we know the distance from the Pythagoras theorem. But this is not the shortest route. We can also do as follows. First, go upwards to make the vertical distances shorter. Then, go back to the plane close to the point C. Then, descend below the plane to make the horizontal distances shorter and go back to the plane to our target. This path is shorter, but it can be still improved. The idea is the same, but we do it more smoothly, without sharp bends. This is the reason why our geodesic oscillates between going up and down. Of course, for points further away, it is better to move up and down just once. The geodesics are only locally shortest. Now, here is a solution which wraps both the x and y coordinates. It is similar to our Euclidean donuts, however, donuts are not homogeneous. The inner circle is shorter than the outer circle, which may feel unnatural to us. We can solve it by using spherical geometry instead. This construction is called the Clifford Taurus. Behold the usual weird effects of spherical geometry, such as going past objects and then seeing the same objects in front of you. Well, it is probably time to wrap up this episode. But of course, there are more ways to embed the Euclidean plane or cylinder in various geometries. We could also immerse not only the Euclidean plane, but also a spherical or hyperbolic plane. As a teaser, here are some embeddings. If you want to play with them by yourself, see the links in the description. Thanks for watching and have a great rest of your day.